Welcome to Orbital Dynamics, the short course. Why teach orbital dynamics? It's fundamental to our business. When designing space systems, we first and foremost think of constellations of satellites. Satellites in orbits have to go at specific velocities when at specific altitudes. The laws of physics demand this. This puts constraints on what sensors can see. This course gives you an understanding of the physics of orbital dynamics and some of its history, so that you can intuitively understand the possibilities in space. In 1957, the Soviet Union launched the first man-made satellite into Earth orbit. Back then, there was only 48 states, Eisenhower was president, and there were no man-made objects in space. In 1958, the U.S. launched its own satellite, Vanguard 1. It's still up there. By 1967, there were 930 objects in space. 10 years later, 3,500. 10 years after that, almost 5,300. And 10 years after that, 7,831. By 2007, there was more than 11,000 objects in space. Since 1957, 30,000 objects have been launched. There are now about 19,000 still in orbit. 902 are operational. Why go to space? Space offers a unique perspective at high altitudes. You're above the atmosphere where more of the Earth is visible. The radio frequency part of the electromagnetic spectrum passes almost transparently through the atmosphere. Space is an excellent place for worldwide communications. This is most of what's done in space. There are parts of the electromagnetic spectrum that are blocked by the atmosphere. Looking from the Earth out into space, you can't see infrared radiation very well. Same goes with X-rays. We place sensors above the atmosphere so we can see this part of the electromagnetic spectrum. It tells us more about the universe. The chemical composition of the atmosphere blocks parts of the electromagnetic spectrum. Space-based sensors looking inward can take measurements of the atmosphere. NASA has an extensive suite of Earth sensors that have supported key research into climate change. Let's first put things into perspective. The moon and sun, as observed from Earth, are about half a degree in diameter. This image is in the proper perspective. Why do the sun and the moon appear to be so small? Well, this is how they actually are. Sunlight, when it hits the atmosphere, is scattered. This is especially true for blue light. The sun literally lights up the whole sky. Maybe that's why it seems much bigger than it actually is. It's worse when the sun and moon are on the horizon. They look even bigger. That is an optical illusion. They actually appear to us smaller, especially the moon. Our perspective is from pictures like this. This is a pretty common way to depict the Earth, Sun, and Moon. And they are way out of perspective. This regrettably gives us a false perspective of our solar system. There's another problem with this picture. You can see features on the Earth and the Moon while the Sun is behind both. Here's what the Earth, Moon, and Sun look like with proper shading. The Earth is a barely perceptible sliver, and the moon is all but gone. This is the realistic view and wouldn't work that well for picture books. Next, I want to talk about the relative motions of celestial objects. It's what led to key discoveries that led to orbital dynamics. Ancient astronomers noticed that certain lights moved across the sky differently from the stars. Everything moves east to west in the night sky. For some objects, however, the motion was, for the most part, faster than the rest of the stars. Occasionally, these objects moved slower than the background stars. They appeared to change direction periodically. The Greeks called these planetoi, which means wanderers. That's how today's word planet was derived. There are five planets that can be seen by the naked eye: Mercury, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn. Uranus can be seen if you know where to look, but since it doesn't move that much, it was missed by the ancients. This animation is in fast motion. It runs from October to July. These apparent motions are very slow. It required good record keeping to observe this. Ancient astronomers tried to account for this retrograde motion. Two of the most influential ancient astronomers were Ptolemy and Hipparchus. They devised a system where these planets and the sun orbited the Earth. It was a geocentric model of the solar system. They synthesized a system of circles called deferents and epicycles to explain a geocentric theory of the solar system. The deferent here is the large circle. The epicycle is the smaller one. The Earth is a blue dot in the middle. The Sun is a yellow dot, and Mars is the red dot. This accounts for the apparent retrograde motion of Mars as seen from Earth. Ptolemy believed that the planets and Sun orbited the Earth in the following order: Mercury, Venus, Sun, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn. This system became known as the Ptolemaic system and predicted the positions of the planets accurately enough for naked eye observations, although it made some ridiculous predictions about their motions, such as that the distance of the Moon should vary by a factor 2 over its orbit. While this predicted the motion of planets well, astronomers weren't able to devise a law of physics that explained the highly irregular motion. In fact, many believed that this kind of motion was not likely. These were mathematical models used to predict orbits, not a model of their motion. Ptolemy and the others that followed him worked hard to come up with tables that would tell astronomers where these objects would appear in the sky at a given time in the future. In order to gain more precision, they had to add epicycles upon epicycles. The math got really complicated. Despite that, this was the best method for naked eye observation for hundreds of years. Long before Ptolemy, a Greek astronomer named Aristarchus realized the Sun was huge and suggested that it, and not the Earth, was at the center of the universe. Later, after Ptolemy, Nicholas Copernicus formulated a comprehensive heliocentric cosmology, which more formally displaced the Earth from the center of the universe. Copernicus's epical book on the revolution of the celestial spheres, published just before his death, is often regarded as the starting point of modern astronomy and the defining epiphany that began the scientific revolution. His heliocentric model with the Sun at the center of the universe demonstrated that the observed motions of the celestial objects can be explained without putting Earth at rest in the center of the universe. All the spheres revolve around the Sun as their midpoint, and therefore the Sun is the center of the universe. What appear to us as motions of the Sun arise not from its motion, but from the motion of the Earth and our sphere with which we revolve about the Sun like any other planet. The Earth has, then, more than one motion. It spins and orbits the Sun. The apparent retrograde motion of the planets arises not from their motion, but from the Earth's motion in conjunction with the planets. Copernicus's theory was geometric and philosophical. He had no empirical theory to back it up and didn't offer better predictions of future location of the planets in the heavens. The theory lay dormant until revived by Kepler, then Galileo, then Newton. This animation compares the two methods. It compares geocentric to heliocentric motion. In Copernicus's model, the apparent retrograde motion was caused by the Earth being in an interior orbit relative to Mars. If you compare the two systems by looking at the two blue lines, they are not that far off. This is why the Copernican system was not adopted until many years later. Kepler revolutionized astronomy and was the father of orbital dynamics. Johannes Kepler was a German mathematician, astronomer, and astrologer, and a key figure in the 17th century scientific revolution. He could not have achieved what he did without the help from a Danish nobleman named Tycho Brahe. Brahe, known for his accurate and comprehensive astronomical and planetary observations, was well known in his lifetime as an astronomer and alchemist. No one before Tycho had attempted to make so many planetary observations. He achieved his goal of measuring to 1 minute of arc. That's 1/60th of a degree. This was a tremendous feat, given that this was before the invention of the telescope. His aim was to confirm his own picture of the universe, which was that the Earth was at rest, the Sun went around the Earth, and the planets all went around the Sun, an intermediate theory between Ptolemy and Copernicus. In early 1600, Kepler met Tycho Brahe, where his new observatory was being constructed. Over the next 2 months, he stayed as a guest, analyzing some of Tycho's observations of Mars. Tycho guarded his data closely, but was impressed by Kepler's theoretical ideas, and soon allowed him more access. Kepler planned to test his theories based on Brahe's Mars data. Kepler had spent years developing many theories and realized that Tycho's data could settle the question of how planets orbited. He went to work for Tycho later in 1600. Brahe died the following year because of complications from a burst bladder. At a banquet, he drank copious amounts of liquids and felt it would be rude to get up. Others believed that he may have been poisoned, and some suggest that it was Kepler. Regardless, after Tycho's death, Kepler stole his data before the Brahe family could secure it. Over the next 11 years, Kepler then developed his laws of planetary motion that resulted in predictions that were 1,500 times better than Ptolemaic methods. Kepler devoted 6 years before Tycho's death, struggling with the motion of the planet Mars. Because the observed irregularities of its motion were greater than those of any other planet, the motion of Mars could not easily be described in terms of the ideal of uniform circular motion. He sought to discover a smooth continuous curve in which the planets orbited. Accepting the Copernican view that the Earth orbited the Sun meant he had to find this curve on the basis of observations from a moving Earth, which itself probably orbited the Sun in a non-uniform way. Kepler knew that the length of the Martian year was 687 days, and he of course knew the length of an Earth year was 365 days. He identified the dates on which Mars would return to a given point in its orbit, that's one Martian year. This animation shows the period of Earth and Mars relative to the Sun. And you can see here, you can see here that for each Martian year, the Earth orbits the Sun about 1 3/4 times. One Martian year is actually 1.88 Earth years. Here's how Kepler derived the relative positions. Consider a point M that has the Earth in a straight line with the Sun. In the 687 days it takes Mars to return to point M, the Earth moves 687 divided by 365, or 1.88 revolutions. That's a total angle of 667 degrees, or 11.82 radians. That's 43 degrees less than two complete revolutions. Thus, when Mars is again at point M, the Earth is at point E1. One Martian year later, Mars will be again at point M, but the Earth will be at point E2, which is 43 degrees from E1. Tycho had 25 years of data, allowing Kepler to fix 12 points on the orbit of Mars. By locating the Earth's position on successive Martian years, Kepler succeeded in constructing a plot of the Earth's orbit. He found it to be indistinguishable from a circle, except that the Sun was slightly displaced from the center. If you look closely at the image on the right, you'll see the red dot is slightly offset to the left of center, which is the green dot. Kepler's plot of the Earth's orbit revealed that the Earth moves fastest when it's nearest the Sun. This led to a second law, which we'll talk about later. Knowing the orbit of the Earth, he was able to plot other positions of Mars at other times in the Martian year. He determined the shape of the orbit of Mars as seen from the Sun. The points did not line up well with a circular orbit. He found the shape was oval. The disagreement in the data in an ideal circular path was 8 seconds of arc. Here, Tycho's measurement accuracy proved vital. Prior to Tycho, measurement accuracy was within 10 seconds of arc. Tycho achieved 1 to 2 seconds of arc of measurement accuracy. Without this accuracy, Kepler wouldn't have noticed an oval Mars orbit. Faced with giving up the Ptolemaic ideal of circular motion or violating Tycho's observations, Kepler chose to believe Tycho's observations. After months of agonizing calculations, Kepler fit the orbit of Mars with an ellipse. This is how he formulated his first law. Here's a quote from Kepler's Astronomia Nova, published in 1609. "I was almost driven to madness in considering and calculating the matter. I cannot find out why the planet Mars would rather go on an elliptical orbit. Oh, ridiculous me! With reasoning derived from physical principles agreeing with experience, there is no figure left for the orbit of the planet except for a perfect ellipse. I thought and searched until I went nearly mad for a reason why the planet Mars preferred an elliptical orbit. Ah, what a foolish bird I had been." Lucky for Kepler, the orbit of Mars, after Mercury, was the most oval-shaped orbit in the visible sky. Pluto is more oval, but wasn't discovered until well after Kepler. Kepler's laws were radical claims. The prevailing belief, particularly in epicycle-based theories, was that orbits should be perfect circles. A circle is actually a form of an ellipse. Most of the planets follow orbits of low eccentricity, which are closely approximated as circles. It was not immediately evident that the orbits were elliptical. Detailed calculations for the orbit of the planet Mars first indicated to Kepler its elliptical shape, and he inferred that the other heavenly bodies, including those far away from the Sun, followed elliptical paths too. Kepler came up with this theory by fitting Brahe's data to a geometric model. Kepler didn't have a law of physics to back this up. That wouldn't come until Newton. Hence, Kepler didn't understand why orbital paths were ellipses. All he knew was that ellipses fit the data better, and they enabled him to make vastly more accurate predictions, 1,500 times better. Kepler's first law is that the shape of orbits is an ellipse. Here's the nearly circular path of Earth orbiting around the Sun. The ancients knew the Sun was not at the center, but didn't realize the orbit was only slightly circular. They thought the offset was a peculiarity. Kepler suggested it was a focus point of the Earth's elliptical orbit. Here's Mars. It too looks circular, but is actually a bit more elliptical than the Earth, so much so that the center is even more offset. Prior to Kepler, astronomers dealt with these discrepancies. The Ptolemaic tables were precise enough for naked eye observations. Kepler's methods, however, being 1,500 times more precise, were eventually preferred over Ptolemy's. Here's an exaggerated diagram. This is a highly elliptical orbit. None of our planets orbit this way, but it shows that the Sun is at one focus, and it could be at either one. The orbiting planet here traces it out an ellipse. How do we draw an ellipse? Here's how you trace one out. The longest width of the ellipse is the major axis. The sum of the two lengths of the line segments A and B equals the major axis. Half the major axis is the semi-major axis. If you were to connect a string, the length of the major axis to the two focal points, and then trace around with a pen holding the string taut, you'd end up with an ellipse. The sum of the distances to both focal points from any point on the ellipse is always equal to the length of the major axis. That's the fundamental definition of an ellipse. And so here's how you would draw one, holding a pencil so that A and B are always taut. And A plus B always equals the major axis. Eccentricity is a measure of the shape of the ellipse. It's the ratio of the length from the center to a focal point, and either focal point is fine. So it's the ratio of the length from the center to a focal point and the length from the point, from the topmost point to the same focal point. As the eccentricity approaches zero, the shape gets circular. And as it approaches one, the shape collapses. So here, this is eccentricity of zero, and you can see the focal points collapse into one. And this is eccentricity of one, and you can see the focal points spread until they're coincident with the major axis. The farthest point of the ellipse along the major axis is called apoapsis. The closest part is called periapsis. For a body orbiting the Sun, the periapsis point is called perihelion, and the apoapsis point is called aphelion. The prefix helio is taken from the Greek word for helium. Long ago, the Sun was discovered to have helium. Turns out it has much more hydrogen, but the term helio stuck. This would be the path that an object takes that orbits a planet, like the Earth. For an Earth orbit, periapsis is called perigee, and apoapsis is called apogee. After determining the shape of an orbit, Kepler had to deal with the timing of the orbit along its elliptical path. Kepler's second law states that an orbiting body sweeps out the same area in the same time in any part of the orbit along an ellipse. You can see from this animation that at the apoapsis point, where the body is farther away, it goes slower, and at the periapsis point, where it's closer, it goes faster. Here's what the time in the orbit looks like. The planet moves faster when closer in and slower when further out. Ten years later, Kepler derived his third law. It dealt with the relative periods of the orbits of planets. Kepler's third law states that the square of the orbital period of a planet is proportional to the cube of its semi-major axis. Let's start with the semi-major axes of the planets. I've expressed these in astronomical units. One astronomical unit is the semi-major axis of the Earth orbit. That's the distance from the Earth to the Sun. This makes the math much easier. Here are the orbital periods of each of the planets. To make the math easier again, I put the periods in terms of Earth years. Earth's period is thus one Earth year, Mercury is a quarter of a year, Neptune is just short of 165 Earth years, and so on. These are the semi-major axes cubed, and these are the squares of the period. And here's the ratio of each one, the periods squared over each of the semi-major axes cubed. They're all about one. They aren't precisely the same. The inner planets from Mars to Mercury are pretty close. The outer planets are a bit off. Kepler's third law was the most accurate prediction in his day. It was a vast improvement over the Ptolemaic system, but it wasn't perfect. Here are the eccentricities. They vary from planet to planet. Mercury has the most eccentric orbit. Many of these are nearly circular. Eccentricity, however, has no bearing on Kepler's third law. The period of an orbit is solely a function of the semi-major axis, not the eccentricity or the shape of the ellipse. The ratios here are only good for planets orbiting the Sun. Here are the parameters for the Moon. The Moon orbits the Earth. Its semi-major axis and period is in relation to the Earth. Look at the ratio column. It's much, much less than 1. That's a much different value than the one for the planets. Kepler's third law says that the square of the orbital period is directly proportional to the cube of the semi-major axis, but that only holds for a common central body. Satellites orbiting the Earth would have a ratio of 1. Another central body would have a different ratio. For instance, the moons of Jupiter would be different still. If you were to compare the periods to the circumferences of the ellipse, you'd notice that the inner planets travel at faster speeds than the outer planets. This makes sense since the period squared is proportional to the semi-major axis cubed. The circumference of the ellipse is a function of semi-major axis. As the semi-major axis increases, the period also increases, but much less. Here's an animation that demonstrates this for the inner planets. Mercury has the smallest semi-major axis and thus travels along its orbit faster. Of the inner planets, Mars has the longest semi-major axis and travels the slowest over the longest path. What astronomers wanted to know was, where would a planet be at a specific time? The location of an orbital body is referred to as its true anomaly. Kepler invented an ingenious method for determining the position of a planet on its elliptical path for a given time, the true anomaly. And true anomaly is denoted here by theta. R is the length of the position vector from the focal point to the position of the planet, P. And it's derived with this equation. The position of the planet P is at some time t. The line from the focal point F to P is the planet's position vector. Kepler's formulas, which I'm about to show you, enable you to derive the position P along the ellipse at any time t. He started by drawing a circle with the same semi-major axis. Remember from his third law that if the planet were orbiting along this circle, the period would be the same as if it were orbiting along the ellipse. In fact, let's put a point P on the circle where the planet would be in time t. This is called the mean anomaly. Deriving the location of a planet on a circle at a given time is simple. Hence, the mean anomaly can be derived easily. Kepler then drew a vertical line through P up to the circle to a point on the circle Q. Let's draw that position vector from the origin to Q. This angle is called the eccentric anomaly. Here's Kepler's equation. It says the mean anomaly M is equal to the eccentric anomaly E minus the eccentricity epsilon times the sine of E. He worked out this formula for theta. This equation is based on epsilon, the eccentricity, and E, the eccentric anomaly. That means in Kepler's equation we need to solve for E. But it turns out you can't convert Kepler's equation to an equation for E. That means you have to guess. Then you see what you get for M, you guess again, see if you get closer, and so on. Remember, deriving M is easy. Deriving E is not that hard. You just have to iterate. But you can only get close. You can never get exact. Once you know E, you can solve for theta using the other equation, and you can solve for R using the third equation. Even though Kepler's methods provided better predictions, many still didn't believe that the Sun, not the Earth, was at the center of the universe. By the way, even as late as the 1700s, astronomers didn't realize that we live in a galaxy and ultimately in a universe of galaxies. The Sun is at the center of a solar system. Their universe is now our solar system. Galileo was an Italian physicist, mathematician, astronomer, and philosopher who played a major role in the scientific revolution. His achievements include improvements to the telescope and consequent astronomical observations and support for Copernicanism. Galileo has been called the father of modern observational astronomy, the father of modern physics, and the father of modern science. He built the first astronomical telescope based on designs invented by Hans Lippershey in the Netherlands and improved it to the point where it provided 30x magnification. On January 7, 1610, Galileo observed with his telescope what he described at the time as three fixed stars, totally invisible by their smallness, all close to Jupiter and lying on a straight line through it. Observations on subsequent nights showed that the positions of these stars relative to Jupiter were changing in a way that would have been inexplicable if they had been really fixed stars. On January 10th, Galileo noticed that one of them had disappeared, an observation which he attributed to its being hidden behind Jupiter. Within a few days, he concluded that they were orbiting Jupiter. He had discovered three of Jupiter's four largest satellites, or moons. He discovered the fourth on the 13th of January. These satellites are now called Io, Europa, Ganymede, and Callisto, later renamed to the Galilean satellites in his honor. His observations of the satellites of Jupiter created a revolution in astronomy. A planet with smaller planets orbiting it did not conform to the principles of Aristotelian cosmology, which held that all heavenly bodies should circle the Earth. Many astronomers and philosophers initially refused to believe Galileo could have discovered such a thing. Galileo also observed Venus going through all phases, including being fully illuminated. The Ptolemaic model didn't allow for that. The Keplerian model did. Also notice that it is at its biggest, up to an arc minute, as it becomes new. It then shrinks when it becomes full. This could only happen if Venus and Earth orbited the Sun with Venus in an interior orbit. This discovery, along with the moons orbiting Jupiter, led Galileo to believe that the Sun had to be at the center of the solar system. Here's Venus and the Sun orbiting the Earth in a Ptolemaic system. Notice that you never see a full Venus. You could if the orbit of Venus in this model were allowed to rotate around the deferent so that it's opposite the Sun from an Earth perspective. Then Venus would go through all phases, but that model wouldn't predict the position of Venus accurately. The positions would be way off. Venus was never observed to be that far away from the Sun. In the Ptolemaic system, the deferent for Venus has to stay in line with the Sun, as this animation shows, meaning that it would never be fully illuminated by the Sun from an Earth's perspective. Notice, too, that when Venus is new or dark, it's at its smallest, and then as it goes dark again, it's at its biggest. Which theory is correct, heliocentrism or geocentrism? Well, the answer is neither. Here's what a geocentric solar system looks like. And in fact, this is what Brahe had suggested. Conceptually, we say this is wrong, although in our everyday speaking, we are very geocentric. We use terms like sunrise and sunset. We even refer to the planets as rising and setting. The odd planetary motion to us is retrograde motion, even though we have a model that tells us the planets don't change direction. In some respects, you could say that Galileo proved that the Ptolemaic model had flaws. If you were to use this model that Tycho Brahe came up with, the motions and the relative alignments are all right. This doesn't come down to right or wrong. It comes down to simplicity, intuitiveness, and convention. Here's what a heliocentric solar system looks like. This model of the solar system started with Aristarchus. The concept was reintroduced by Copernicus. Both theories were conceptual. A geometric and mathematical model was developed by Kepler. His theory was empirical, but it was a theory that fit Tycho Brahe's data. Heliocentrism was proven by Galileo. He didn't build on the theory, he just provided evidence for it. Kepler and Galileo had no idea why the planets orbited the way that they did. All they did was derive a model that characterized what they saw. A physics-based model that describes some of the underlying mechanisms would have to wait until Newton. This is what the solar system looks like from a galactic perspective in the Milky Way. I want to say something about these frames of reference. I'm going to suggest that none of them is wrong, which implies none of them is the proper frame of reference. Let's talk about the essence of a scientific theory. It will help you to understand why we prefer a heliocentric model of the solar system. Stephen Hawking, in A Brief History of Time, states, "A theory is a good theory if it satisfies two requirements. It must accurately describe a large class of observations on the basis of a model that contains only a few arbitrary elements. And it must make definite predictions about the results of future observations." He goes on to state, any physical theory is always provisional, in the sense that it is only hypothesis. You can never prove it conclusively. No matter how many times the results of experiments agree with some theory, you can never be sure that the next time the result will not contradict the theory. On the other hand, you can disprove a theory by finding even a single observation that disagrees with the predictions of the theory. The unprovable but falsifiable nature of theories is a necessary consequence of using inductive logic. This scientific philosophy didn't originate with Stephen Hawking. It was developed by Sir Karl Popper. He coined the term critical rationalism to describe his philosophy. Popper held that scientific theories are abstract in nature and can only be tested indirectly by reference to their implications. Scientific theory and human knowledge generally is irreducibly conjectural or hypothetical, and is generated by the creative imagination in order to solve problems like how to determine the future positions of planets. No number of positive outcomes of experimental testing can confirm a scientific theory explicitly. A single counterexample can refute a theory. However, it shows the theory from which the implication is derived to be false. A theory being falsifiable does not mean it's been proven false. Rather, it means that it can be shown by observation or experiment to be false. Some use the term refutable, others use the term testable. Popper's asymmetry between verification and falsifiability lies at the heart of his philosophy of science. It inspired him to take falsifiability as his criterion of demarcation between what is and is not genuinely scientific. A theory should be considered scientific if and only if it is falsifiable, refutable, or testable. Asserting a belief that cannot be tested is thus not a scientific theory. The fourth criteria for scientific theories embraces a concept called Occam's razor. It is a term coined by philosophers that came after Sir William of Ockham and refers to distinguishing between two hypotheses, either by shaving away unnecessary assumptions or cutting apart two similar conclusions. Of two equivalent theories or explanations, all other things being equal, the simpler one is preferred. Albert Einstein said, "Make everything as simple as possible, but not simpler." Copernicus wrote, "The motions of the sun, moon, and other solar system planets can be calculated using a geocentric model with the Earth at the center, or using a heliocentric model with the sun at the center. Both work, but the geocentric system requires many more assumptions than the heliocentric one. If you compare the math required for the Keplerian system versus that required for the Ptolemaic system, Kepler's is far simpler. It is not that geocentrism is wrong. Heliocentrism is simpler, more intuitive, and that's why it's preferred."